Hello everyone, I am Emmanuel Gobel from École Polytechnique Paris. I'm pleased to present the joint work with Cyril Benezet and Rodrigo Targino about how to sample a model with an untractable copula function and the application to tail events and in a factor copula model. This is a work supported by the shear stress test. So first I'm going to recall how to sample a given copula model. Okay, so let's say you are interested in sampling X, taking value in RD, so you have D components. You know the marginal of this model, and the copula function is known through another model, which has the same copula. So let's say you can sample a random variable Y, which has the same copula as X. You know the marginal CDF of Y, and so the algorithm is the following. So this is the basic algorithm. You sample Y, you transform component-wise the sample through using the marginal CDF of Y. So this is the GI here. So what you do is a monotone increasing transformation of the component of Y. So of course, doing so, you keep the same dependency, so the same copula function, and then you apply the quantile function to this vector u, and so you obtain a random variable x which has the same copula and as y, so that is the copula c, and with the right marginal because the ui are uniformly distributed on the very mild assumption on the continuity of the CDF of y. Okay, so of course this algorithm is very basic and requires the knowledge of the GI, and so we are in a situation where sometimes the GIs are not known. This is typically the case in a factor copula model. So what is a factor copula model? This is a model typically developed by O and Patton, 2017. This is used to model the daily returns of SP100. So typically, from historical data, what you're going to fit is a marginal distribution for each component of this S&P 100. You're going to fit a student distribution, but it's not that important here. And connected and in relation with each of these components, you're going to associate an industry sector. So you have seven industry sectors. And these sectors will be used to model the dependency between the components of the X. So here we're going to use a linear factor model for the copula. So there's a market-wise common factor which is M naught, which has a skew T distribution with some parameter. You have some sector-specific risk factor MS, so you have seven sector-specific risk factors, and you have idiosyncratic factors specific to each component, which is also distributed like a student distribution. And then you write a linear combination of these different factors according to the sector of each component. Okay. Okay. Also, here this is a linear factor copula because you have a linear relation, but of course you could generalize this to a nonlinear transformation with arbitrary random variable z. In all these situations, in any case, the marginal CDF of y are not explicit because you are mixing some complex distribution. And of course, the sum of these or the mixture of these complex distribution has no explicit form for regarding the CDF. So what we like to compute is typically statistics of X, so some function of X, and we'd like to take the expectation. We also like to take a condition expectation of this. And in case where we are considering a tail event, so in case where this X given A is a rare event, of course, naive sampling of X or Z is not efficient at all because you can accept very rarely the proposal, and so you'd like to come up with a MCMC sampler to get more efficient estimation of the quantities of interest. So typically this kind of condition computation appears for several applications. Typically you'd like to compute tail dependency, so that is the probability that one component is very large conditionally to the other components are very large. Or you'd like to compute semi-correlation, so the correlation restricted to a positive value for the quantities or negative values, okay? Or you'd like to compute a K expected shortfall, so that is the average of one component given that the other ones, at least K plus one other ones, are very large. Okay, so this is, in any case, situation where you need to use at some point MPMC sampler. And of course, there's some situation, natural situation, where the distribution of the Z, remember that the Z allows you to simulate the Y, the simulation of the Z, the distribution of the Z is quite complex, so you cannot directly sample the Z, you have to use a MCMC sampler. Okay, so to summarize the notation, we have an instrumental random variable Z, which is which takes value in R capital D. D may be very large. Okay, we transform the Z to get the Y, so we use a phi transformation. The phi is known, and the copula we are interested in. Is the copula generated by the Y, okay? But we don't know the marginal of the Y, so this is the GI here. So ideally, what we like to do is, once we have the Y, we like to transform marginally the Y into uniformly distributed random variable UI here, and then apply the quantile function, so the inverse CDF of the X, to get the right distribution for the X with the right marginal and the right dependency. The critical point is we don't know the GI in our setting. And as an input tool, what we are allowed to do is to simulate Z not exactly, but through an ergodic Markov chain defined by a kernel P, a Markov kernel P. And this ergodic Markov chain will have, of course, the distribution of Z as invariant distribution. In fact, we typically assume that this Markov chain is geometrically ergodic. Okay, so what will be the scheme we're going to analyze? This is a scheme where we compute along the iteration the empirical CDF of the YI and compose this empirical CDF with the simulation we have. So typically, this is what we are doing. So there's an iteration with n step. At step k, what we do is to sample a new point according to the Markov kernel, starting from the previous point z key minus one. Then we transform the z key through the function phi. We obtain the yk, so with a vector of dimension small d. And then we compute the empirical CDF of the yk component by component. And for certain technical reason and for stability, we need to modify a bit this empirical CDF to avoid value, it takes the value 0 or 1. So we modify a bit with something of size 1 over 2 squared k. Of course, it could be different from 1 over 2, it could be 1 over a constant square root k, but the rate 1 over square root k is important in the analysis of the algorithm. So this is a modification of the empirical CDF of GY, and then we apply to each component of Y this empirical CDF. So we obtain something which is close to one variable which has a uniform distribution 0, 1, and then we apply the quantile function to get at the end a candidate for the sampling of X. Okay, so what are the errors in the algorithms? The errors come from the empirical CDF of G and the fact that the YK have not exactly the distribution of Z, but only, no, sorry, the Z have not the right distribution of the right distribution, that is the distribution of Z, but only a distribution which converges weakly to the target distribution. So the question we ask is, what is the accuracy of this empirical average over the sample when we want to compute the explanation of G of X? So far, we see the algorithm for computing statistics of g of x. Later, we will see an algorithm where we compute the statistics of g of x conditionally to some event x given in A, typically. So I'm going to give details now about the rate of convergence of this approximation. So for this, we need some assumption, and I'm going to explain what is the role of this assumption in proving some quantitative result. So the first assumption we need is we need the Markov chain ZK defined through the Markov kernel P to be geometrically ergodic, and this is encoded by a Lyapunov function, okay, L. And typically, once we have this information, we know that we can estimate uniformly the convergence of the unpackled CDF of Y compared to the true CDF, okay, uniformly on the real line. And the rate of convergence in LP norm is n to the power minus p divided by 2p plus 1. Okay, so the larger the p, the closer to the order of convergence, 1/2. Okay, so this is the one result we have. So we have convergence of the margin of the unpackled CDF. Now we need for the algorithm to be sure that this random variable v can be integrable, because at the end we're going to compose with v with quantile function of the x. So to ensure this, we're going to ask that for some exponent q max, and for any, so there's a critical exponent q max, for such that for any q larger than q max, the gi composed with the phi I are bounded in LP norm, in L norm. So what does it mean? It means that the sup of this function divided by L is bounded uniformly in RD. Okay? And we need the marginal CDF to be continuous. So this is just a technical assumption. And using this property, this is enough to prove that the VI are integrable. So typically, have in mind the critical value minus 1. You see that the V should be close to a uniform distribution on 0, 1. So the critical value Q equal minus 1 corresponds to just the integrability of 1 over U for uniformly distributed. So of course, we cannot take Q equal minus 1, but we can get any value close to minus 1. Okay, so these two assumptions ensure in a way that we have negative moments for this pseudo uniform random variable. And then we're going to compose the test function G with the quantile function. So of course, if G is has a non-compact support, you are interested in the rate of in the growing rate of G close to the boundary of the unit cube. And so this is the role of this assumption. Is it this composed function? Is it a smooth function? So it will be locally Lipschitz. And what is the growth of the Lipschitz constant? So it may explode at the boundary of the hypercube at the rate 1 over alpha plus 1, 1 over u to the power 1 alpha plus 1, close to 0, close to 1. Okay, so typically, I will give an example, but typically if F have some AV tails, then alpha will be, this alpha here will be positive. So you may allow a phi to explode at the boundary of the of your domain. Okay, so these are realistic situations. Of course, this is more challenging to analyze, but this is realistic in practice to assume this kind of assumption. And so at the end, when you combine all these four assumptions, what we have is a convergence in LP for any p between 1 and the maximal exponent, which is a ratio between Qmax, which is typically given by this assumption. So typically, Qmax is often equal to minus 1, and an alpha, which is the weight of explosion of this test function at the boundary of the domain. So the rate will be, the order of the rate of complement will be 1 over 2p minus alpha divided by 2q max plus any iota, positive iota. Okay, so we are interested. Okay, so the critical situation where correspond to a situation where alpha is very large. So of course, alpha close to zero is very nice. It correspond. We will see that it correspond to a light tail model for the X. Okay, so this is a summary of the discussion about this parameter. So typically, when the G has a compact support. So everything when the G is bounded, the G then which was locally Lipschitz now is globally Lipschitz. So you don't have to care too much about the alpha here, and this assumption can be much simplified. In that case, the rate of convergence can be much improved here. I'm not going to detail this case because the interesting case corresponds to a non-compactly supported function G. For Gaussian distribution with possible restriction, we know which sampler to use. Typically, we will use a PCN sampler. I will detail this later, which gives Qmax equal to minus 1. And I will detail this later. And when the marginal CDF of Y are related to Pareto distribution with index AI, then the alpha is explicit and is given by 1 over the mean of this index. And so the take-home message to have here is that the larger the AI, so that is the lighter the tail, then of course the smaller the alpha, and then the better the convergence you have at the end. Okay. So of course, naturally, what you expect is that when you have light tails, then the convergence will be better than in the case compared to the case where you have heavy tails for your vector X. I'm going to give the variant of the algorithm where we are more interested in computing the conditional expectation of G of X given an event A. So typically, the event A will be X in a subset of RD. Because the marginal CDF of X are explicit, of course, if you know AX, you know the transform domain AI associated to the value Y in which it takes value. So if A takes value in a set AX, then it is equivalent to know the set AI in which Y takes values. Okay. And of course, this is similar for AZ because there's a deterministic transform, you know, to go from Z to Y. So something you have to be aware, of course, is that although you are interested by a conditional expectation to compute at the end, because of the copula definition, you still need to compute the unconditional CDF of YI in algorithm 1. Okay? Even if the outer expectation is conditioned to a subset of value of X, inside the algorithm where you simulate X, you need the unconditional CDF of Y. So you need to do something. And if typically A is a rare event, you have to account for these extreme values in the way you simulate YI. Otherwise, your estimation of the CDF will be very noisy and very inaccurate. So one way to proceed is to compute the marginal CDF in two parts using the Bayes rule. So you're going to compute one marginal CDF, so conditioned to A, 1 over conditioned to A complementary, and then of course weight this quantity using the probability of A. So at the end, in this conditional setting, you need three Monte Carlo sampler, each for these three quantities, so two conditional CDF and one unconditional probability P of A or P of A complementary. Okay, so here I'm going to detail the most challenging part, so that is related to the conditional CDF. Compute P of A, you can do it with naive naive Monte Carlo sampler or MCMC sampler using splitting algorithm. I'm not going to detail this because this is a more standard part. Okay, to simulate something which is conditionally on A, what we're going to use is MCMC sampler with acceptance rejection inside the set A. We know that if the initial MCMC sampler is a symmetric Markov chain, respect the stationary distribution of Y, then when you incorporate an extra acceptance rejection step, then it will be still ergodic and stationary ergodic sampler, which stationary distribution is the restricted distribution of Y to the set A. Okay, so this is a way to maintain everything coherent in this MCMC sampler. So at the end, the algorithm is the following. So here, remember that I'm going to assume that P of A is pre-computed in the first stage, typically. So to compute this CDF, now I'm going to run two Markov chain. One with Markov kernel for this condition distribution. One with another Markov kernel here. And I'm going to accept or reject the value, the proposal for each one. Okay, so there's an iteration of our n step. I'm going to consider the Markov chain in A. So I'm going to use a first Markov kernel PA, okay? So it could be its parameters depends on A typically. And one, I'm going to sample a proposal ZK A. I'm going to accept this if it is in the right set A, or I'm going to reject and stay on the previous sample if it is not in A. Then I'm going to transform this ZKA into YKA through the non-function phi. And I'm going to do the same for the other Markov chain, but this time this is acceptance only in a complementary set AK. So really I'm running synchronously two Markov chain in parallel. Okay, from these two parallel Markov chain, I'm going to compute an unconditional CDF. Okay, so this will be this G tilde I here. Okay, so this first part is the conditional CDF of Y conditionally to be in the set A. This is the empirical CDF of Y I conditioned to be in the set A complementary. And then I'm going to modify this. And then I'm going to apply the rest of the algorithm as before. And at the end, I'm going to average the output of the first Markov chain here using the unconditional CDF computed with the two Markov chain. And it will be a candidate for computing the expectation of G of X conditionally to A. And of course, the analysis of the algorithm is the same as before. And the rate of convergence is similar as before. Few things about numerical experiments. So here I'm going to, in all experiments, we're going to use what we call preconditioned Kronecker sampler. So this is well suited for Gaussian distribution for the Z. So this Gaussian sampler is the following. This is a kind of autoregressive sampler. I'm moving from Z key minus one to Z key like this. So I'm going to apply kappa, a factor kappa to the previous computation. And I'm going to add noise epsilon k independent of everything. And epsilon k are just a ID sequence with the right Gaussian distribution here. So that at the end, the distribution of ZK will be asymptotically be N0 identity. And we know that this is a geometric ergodic sampler. This is a well-known fact. Okay. We're going to use to apply this to linear factor copula model from O pattern. So remember the model. So the marginal are given by a student distribution with some parameter. And the YI are just given by a linear mixture of different skew T distribution, student distribution, okay? And everything is independent. Okay, so you see here that we may use instead of Gaussian distribution, in fact, student or skewed distribution. And to use the PCN sampler, we're going to transform Gaussian distribution, in fact, in skewed distribution, in student distribution. So we're going to transform to go from Gaussian noise to skewed and student distribution. So in fact, this is quite simple. What we do is for the first component M naught, we're going to use a first Gaussian distribution. We're going to transform Gaussian distribution into a uniform distribution by just applying the CDF of Gaussian standard Gaussian distribution. Okay, so doing so, we obtain a uniform distribution, and then we apply the quantile of this skewed distribution to get a simulation of the first skewed distribution here. We are doing the same for student distribution for MS and epsilon I, and we are done. And everything, all the components Z are independent, and we apply a Markov chain on these Gaussian distributed Z. We'd like to compute the key expected shortfall. So here we consider the case where all we're going to condition respect to all components are greater than a threshold C. So it corresponds to the case where, so here we have 100 components. So all the components at the same time are greater than 1%. Okay, so remember that the LX are modeling the components of the SP100, in fact, the daily returns. So here we are considering the event where all the components, in fact, these are negative the losses of these of the components. So all the components of the SP100 incur losses of 1%. Okay, and we like to compute typically what are the losses of one component Xi given that the all the other components incur severe losses simultaneously. So we're going to focus on three marginals, three components, the fifth, the first, and the second. Why? So, because it appears that the first, the fifth one is heavy-tailed. So in fact, according to the parameter we have calibrated, in fact, it corresponds to the case where this component, the fifth component has finite mean but infinite variance. While the first and second has both finite mean and variances, mean and variance. Okay, so the first, the fifth one has heavy tail, and the other ones have a light tail. So remember the result here is that typically when you have light tails in the distribution you are interested in, you may have a faster convergence or better convergence. So this is what we are going to observe here. So what are these plots? So typically here, we run the algorithm as presented before. So the black curve corresponds to the component we have where we have heavy tail. Okay, and the red and blue curve correspond to a component where we have light tail. So you see that the estimation for the heavy tail component is much noisy. So this is it is just to illustrate that the convergence occurs, but the convergence is much slower than for the other components. And here, these light color plots correspond to several replica of the algorithm just to see the variances of the estimator. So you see that, of course, in the case of heavy tails, you have much variability in the algorithm, which is, of course, expected by this kind of algorithm. Okay, but in any case, the algorithm is converging and everything is fine. Okay, so thank you for listening. This is, I'm going to conclude with a bit of bibliography and references, and feel free to ask me questions if you have any. Thank you.